All right, everyone, how you doing? I think we're mainly here. First thing, let me give you back your quiz. Those of you who are online, you already have your quiz, but let me give you. So first thing we're going to do here is we're going to talk about the quiz. So we struggled more on this quiz, definitely. I think the discouraging thing was that we missed some of the easy questions. We missed some of the hard questions, but we also missed a lot of the easy questions, right? And so this quiz has a number of questions that I think you can expect to see similar types of things on the exam tomorrow. So let's go through this, make sure that we understand what's going on and that we get this straight so that if we missed it on the quiz, we don't miss it again tomorrow. Okay, so question number one, this is about why is aggregate supply upward sloping? Evan, you asked about this question right before the quiz, right? And still a number of us didn't get this one. Why is aggregate supply upward sloping? Two reasons, sticky wages, right? Sticky wages meaning when the price level goes down, because wages are sticky because of efficiency wages or wage contracts, what happens to the real wage? It goes up. This leads to layoffs and cuts in output, right? Once again, when a question says explain, you have to actually explain. A couple of you just said sticky wages, right? Well, it's hard for me to give you full credit if you don't explain, right? So you got to explain this. The other one is imperfect information. Right? And imperfect information is this idea when the price level goes down, people are fooled. And they don't reduce their nominal wage. So as a result, real wages go up, and there's layoffs, and there's a fall in output, right? So you need to talk about at least one of these, right? In some level of detail for me to be able to give you full credit. Question number two, define the concept of money neutrality. In the long run, nominal variables don't affect real variables, right? That's money neutrality. In the long run, nominal variables like inflation don't affect real variables like unemployment or real GDP. So what does this mean about the long run aggregate supply curve? That is a nominal variable. That is a real variable, right? So what's true in the long run? The price level doesn't impact real output in the long run. That's why it's vertical, because the price level can be whatever it is. Real output is going to be based on the natural rate, right? And remember, the natural rate's based on our productivity. Okay, question number three. This is a very good example of the kind of question you're likely to see on tomorrow's exam, okay? So part A, using the aggregate demand, aggregate supply model, begin in the long run equilibrium. You have got to be kidding me. Okay, maybe it's okay, begin in our long run equilibrium. And then it says that there's a tax cut, right? What happens to output and inflation? Okay, one of the things I noticed fairly consistently in this question is a lot of you think you're smarter than the model, right? And by that I mean, you're just kind of, oh yeah, well, this should happen and this should happen. You're not really using the model to think, okay? So when in class we talked about what are the impacts of changes in taxes? And we talked about them primarily impacting aggregate demand. So some of you said, oh, it increased aggregate supply or change long-run aggregate supply, right? But in this model, they primarily impact aggregate demand, right? You need to know the things that shift aggregate demand. So what happens if there's a tax cut? The tax cut will increase aggregate demand. What happens to output? It goes above the natural rate. What happens to prices and inflation? They go up. Okay, so that's part A. You would expect to see output go above the natural rate. Now, part B, if the government or the Fed take no action, how will the economy ever return to the natural rate? Well, notice that when we moved from this point to this point, notice how inflation went up. And now actual inflation is greater than the expected price level, right? Actual inflation is greater than expected inflation at this point. So what happens? People increase their expected price level. And they increase their wages because their real wage has fallen. And so they try to get those wages back. Sometimes this works, sometimes it does not. I don't know why. Okay, this reduces short-run aggregate supply, and what happens? And I cannot believe this. So I got so mad yesterday. I was like, went home last night, I was like, checking all this stuff. It's like, okay, it's working. I get in here, and the second we have class, this technology does not work. Well, damn it. There, now maybe it's working. Right? So short-run aggregate supply moves back here to the left. Output goes back to the natural rate. Okay, that's the part B. Now, part C is what happens if instead of waiting for the economy to solve itself, the Federal Reserve jumps in, right? So there is an increase in output, which drove up prices and drove up output. What happens if the Federal Reserve jumps in? What should it do? the Fed should try to reduce aggregate demand and reduce output back to the natural rate. How should the Fed reduce aggregate demand? As we're going to talk about today, you didn't have to have this. Just having a reduction in aggregate demand is sufficient. But as we're going to talk about today, what the Fed should do is cut the money supply and raise interest rates. Right? That's the way that they can enact the fall on aggregate demand. Okay? So this is the kind of question you're going to see a good deal of tomorrow, right? And so, you know, once again, I think some of you still have not taken the time to develop an understanding of the aggregate demand, aggregate supply model, right? You kind of have it, but you don't really have it. You don't completely know all the things that shift aggregate demand. You don't understand, right? You kind of get it, but you don't quite all completely get it, how the economy solves itself in the long run, right? So it just felt like there was kind of a lot of, like, a little bit, knowing a little bit of what's going on, but not really fully understanding the details. That's exactly the kind of thing that you got to get straight for tomorrow, right? Because you're going to be seeing a good share of this. Okay, question number four. By the way, anyone have any questions? Yeah. If the Fed, so that's this graph right here, right? If the Fed takes no action, then what's going to eventually happen? Expected inflation will rise and wages will rise and short run aggregate supply will shift down or to the left. And so we will move back in this direction, back to the natural rate. Okay? So that's what happens if the Fed takes no action. Yeah, Max. No, there's five. So this is what you have to be looking through your notes, right? We talked about changes in confidence. We talked about changes in the money supply, taxes, transfer payments, government purchases, right? So these are the kind of things you need to know, right? These are the kind of things you know. You got to be able to work with the model, right? Because it felt like there was kind of a lot of freestyling, quite honestly, which is like, well, I'm going to draw this up and then I'm going to kind of tell you a story. But that's not what you're expected to do here, right? You've got to use the model. And to use the model, you've got to know the details. You got to know the mechanics of it. And I really felt that we're not ready for that, right? We weren't ready for the quiz yesterday. We need to be ready for it tomorrow. Okay, question number four. Do budget deficits fall or rise when the economy is expanding, everything else being equal? I think we had a question about this right before the quiz as well. When the economy expands, budget deficits go down, right? When the economy expands, budget deficits go down. And that's because of all those automatic stabilizers that we talked about, right? When the economy gets bigger, the government collects more taxes, they spend less money on welfare and unemployment benefits, the deficit goes down. Question number five. Here is our question about the government spending multiplier. So if you don't know the formula for the government spending multiplier, you're not going to be able to get this question. What's the formula? The government spending multiplier is the change in Y you get from a change in G. The change in Y you get from a change in G is equal to 1 over 1 minus the marginal propensity to consume. That's the formula. In this question, you're told that the marginal propensity to consume is 0.7. So what's the formula? One over one minus 0.7 or 3.33, that's the multiplier. So in this case, in this question, it says, if there's a change in G, 200 million or 200 billion, then what's going to be the change in Y? (3.33) times that, or 666 billion. Okay. So I wouldn't say there's a ton of formulas on the exam tomorrow, but there are a few, particularly related to these multipliers. You got to know the government spending multiplier. You got to know the tax multiplier. You got to know the money multiplier, right? And this afternoon when we do our review session, we can work through some money multiplier problems again if you want to. But these ones are, I think, are also kind of very much fair game for the exam tomorrow. Okay, and then question number six. I think I actually gave this exact example in class. Brazil has a debt to ratio of 65% and Japan has 240%. Which country is most likely to suffer from a debt crisis? Probably Brazil, right? Why? Because as we talked about, the number, that debt to GDP ratio number doesn't mean anything. When do you have a debt crisis? It's all about tolerance, debt tolerance. In other words, what do markets believe? Why does Japan have so much debt? Because markets believe they'll pay it off, right? It's quite that simple. So in some sense, you actually get the opposite of what you'd expect. Countries with a lot of debt are might be more less likely to have a debt crisis because markets believe they're going to pay it back, right? Why has Japan been able to borrow so much? Because markets believe they're going to pay it back, right? As we talked about, most debt crises happen when countries have very low levels of debt. It just goes to show you that it's not the amount of debt, it's really how likely you are to pay it back. And that has to do with that concept of debt tolerance, right? What is your history? What are your institutions? You know, all that kind of stuff. Okay, so that's quiz number four. So, you know, once again, we really want to make sure that we use these quizzes as learning experiences so we don't make the same mistakes on tomorrow's exam. So this afternoon, we're going to spend, the only thing we're going to do this afternoon is a review session, okay? So we will talk about the exam. If you want to work problems, if there's some things from your notes that you're unclear about, you know, whatever you want to talk about, that's what we will do this afternoon, right? Let me just remind you, what's the material that's on the exam? The material is chapter 9 on long run growth, income inequality from my reading, chapter 12 on aggregate demand, aggregate supply, chapter 13 on fiscal policy, and chapter 14 on the money supply and the Fed. So basically everything we did up to yesterday. That's the material that's on the exam. Okay. And once again, the exam, the mechanics of the exam will be exactly the same as before. We'll start at 9. The exam will be the same length. I'll ask you to finish by 11:30. I think last time nobody had any problem with doing that, and I wouldn't expect that to be the case this time. So you should have plenty of time, so make sure you take your time, right? Because that was actually, I think, a big determinant of how well you did on the first exam is how much time you took on. And so anyway, I won't say any more about the exam right now. We'll spend more time talking about it this afternoon, okay? Any quick questions about the exam? Yeah, next. Next week we'll be taking a final exam on Wednesday, right? Speaking of next week, I do want to spend just a couple of minutes talking about your paper assignment, okay? Because remember, that's in your syllabus. We talked about it on the first day of class. We haven't really talked much about it since then. But let's just spend a couple of minutes talking about your paper assignment. We're not going to have class tomorrow afternoon after the exam, okay? So tomorrow afternoon would be a very good time for you to begin to think about your paper assignment in earnest. So what is this assignment? It's a short assignment. I can't even remember what I have in the syllabus, but I think I say something. Anybody have that syllabus? I can't remember. I think I say something like 800 to 1,000 words. So it's only really a couple of pages, right? Only a couple of pages. But what I want you to do is I want you to find a current events article from the news, right? A reputable source, right? Whether it's Wall Street Journal, New York Times, The Economist Magazine, Google News, AP News, whatever, right? right? I mean, I don't really care what the source is as long as it's somewhat reputable. And I want you to provide, use class material to provide some analysis on it, okay? So basically, take some of the things that the ideas that we've talked about in class, and use it to give more insight and analysis to the article, okay? So it doesn't have to be groundbreaking stuff, but just to be able to give a little bit more in-depth detail, right, as to what's going on in this article and how what you learned in this class informs how you read this article, okay? I do want to kind of emphasize a couple of things. First off, it should be on macroeconomics, okay? Macroeconomics. It should relate to one of those six big questions we talk about in class, okay? So don't pick an article about what's happening to the price of IBM stock, right? Because that's not really what we've talked about in this class, right? So it's got to be related to inflation, unemployment, GDP, growth, business cycles, Fed fiscal policy, monetary policy, international trade. I mean, those are the kind of issues that you should be looking at. And second, you know, in my experience, the best papers, the students who've written the best papers have spent a little bit of time looking for a good article, right? If you find a good article and it's one that interests you and it's well written, then the paper will kind of write itself, right? So spend a little bit of time looking, right? Just don't go, you know, type in GDP and the first thing that pops up on Google, do that one, because that's probably not going to be the best approach. I am happy if you pick out a couple of articles, send them to me, and I'm happy to take a quick look and say, yeah, that looks pretty good, or you might want to stay away from this one. Right? Or if you're just unsure, like, is this a topic that works? Yeah, send it to me, right? Particularly if you send it to me like Thursday or Friday or even Saturday, right? If you send it to me Sunday night, I'm not gonna be able to help you much. But yeah, you know, so this would be a very good way to spend your Thursday afternoon after the exam, because it won't be too terribly taxing. Is to begin to look around and find a couple of articles, and you know, if there's a couple that you're kind of unsure about, by all means send it to me, and I'm happy to give you my two cents about what I think might work and what might not. Your question?
How recent does it have to be?
I mean, I think it really depends upon your topic. I mean, if you're interested in writing something about inflation, then it should be pretty recent. Right, because there's lots of very recent articles. If you're interested in writing something a little bit more esoteric, you can go back a little bit. But yeah, I don't want something from like 5 years ago or 10 years ago. Right, I would prefer it to be something in the last few months or at least the last year. Right, but I think most of the topics, most of those six questions, you can find very recent topics on them. Right, I mean, most of those questions you could go to the Wall Street Journal and find something today about those. So, but if you find the perfect article, but it's from 3 months ago, that's okay. You know, that's okay. And once again, if you're uncertain about whether it's too long ago, send it to me, and then I'll give you some feedback. It's better to ask than to do something wrong or to write on a topic that's not really appropriate. So, yeah. So any other questions about this? All right, okay, well, then let's get into what we're gonna talk about today, chapter 15, monetary policy. So remember, what we talk about today is not on your exam tomorrow. Well, I should restate this. I'm not going to test you on the material from chapter 15 explicitly. But that said, you're going to see there's a lot of overlap between what we talk about today and what we talked about on Monday and Tuesday and Friday. So in that sense, this is a good class, because we're really going to go over a lot of things that we've talked about the last 3 or 4 days. And so it's kind of an opportunity to talk through these things again. And, you know, as always, if there's any source of confusion or something unclear, slow me down. Okay. So yesterday, I would say we focused more on the details, right? We talked about what money is. We talked about how the Federal Reserve is set up. We talked about how the Federal Reserve uses open market operations. And we talked about the money multiplier. We kind of talked about the smaller details. Today, we really want to talk about the bigger pictures, the bigger picture. For instance, how does monetary policy impact interest rates? And we want to talk about what are the goals of monetary policy? What are things that central banks or the Federal Reserve should be trying to achieve? Okay. So to help you think about how the Fed thinks about these questions, you've got to think about it in kind of a flow chart. The Fed has tools that they use to hit targets that help them achieve their goals. The Fed has tools that help them hit targets that help them achieve their goals. Okay? What are the tools of monetary policy? Well, we talked about them yesterday. For instance, open market operations. There's a number of tools. We talked about the Fed could also change the required reserve ratio. The Fed could change their discount lending. The Fed could do buy and sell long-term bonds. But in general, open market operations are the primary tool. What's their primary target? Short-term interest rates, particularly the federal funds interest rate. That's the primary target that the Fed sets for itself. To do what? To achieve the goals, primarily low inflation, high output. So the Fed has tools that they use to try to hit targets to achieve their goals. Okay? So, I hate to use sports analogies, but I've never been able to think of a better analogy for this than the golf analogy, right? So, I don't know if any of you play golf. If you never played golf, you probably at least know the details enough to kind of get this analogy. All right, let's say that you're gonna play a hole of golf and it's a par five, right? So that means it's gonna take you at least five shots to get the ball there anywhere close. And if it's me, it's probably gonna take you 20. So you start off on the tee, right? Is it a good strategy for you put the ball on the tee, look out there, see the flag, and be like, okay, I'm aiming right for that thing? No, you're never gonna make it, right? You can't hit the ball right at the flag. It's too far away, right? Unless you're some sort of, you know, one of these monster golfers. So what do? Well, you plan it out. You're like, well, if I want to get the ball on the green in three shots, then I need to put my second shot here, which means I need to put my first shot here. So where should I aim? I should aim maybe to the right side of the fairway, right? And how do I get to that spot? Well, then I got to pick which club I want to use, right? I'm going to use a 3-wood or I'm going to use a 2-iron or whatever it is. Well, this is kind of how the Fed has to think about it. The Fed would like to achieve low inflation and high output, but that goal is way far away, right? So what do? They focus more day to day on the interest rate. Right? Which is kind of like thinking, well, I'm going to hit this first shot in the fairway. What does the interest rate have to be consistent with me achieving these goals? And then from there, they have to figure out the right tool, right? What's the open market operation that gets me to the interest rate I need? Just like a golfer would pick the right club that hopefully will get them to the right spot on the fairway, right? So that's kind of how the Fed has to think about this. And so what I want to do here this morning is kind of try to walk through this process. How the Fed links open market operations to interest rates, and then we'll talk about how interest rates, right, relate to the Fed's long-term goals of inflation and output. So let's talk about monetary policy and interest rates. Short-term interest rates. What is a short-term interest rate? In a real sense, this is the price of obtaining money. All right, when we talk about short-term interest rates, it is about getting money. Right? Remember our definition of finance? Finance is trading money across time with conditions attached. And this is particularly true for short-term interest rates, right? And by short-term interest rates, I mean interest rates that are on loans that are less than a year. But we're going to be talking about the federal funds interest rate. How long are most federal funds loans? They're denominated in hours. 1 hour, 2 hour, 6 hours, 8 hours. I mean, very, very short. So you might ask, well, why in the world does somebody need to borrow money for 6 hours? They need money, right? They need money. They need instant cash. And what's the price you pay for instant cash? It's a short-term interest rate, right? It's a short-term interest rate. So short-term interest rates are, in many ways, the price of getting money right now, right? If I need money now and not 8 hours from now, I got to pay a short-term interest rate for that. Well, if it's a price, then what determines price? Supply and demand, right? Just like anything else, in a market economy has a supply and demand, money has a supply and demand. So we can think about a market here where people trade money. And by trading money, I mean they're trading, you know, literally money, right? They're trading transfer payments, right, between banking accounts or currency. And up here, we have the interest rate. And let's just use the little r. And here we have the demand for money and is downward sloping. Why? Because what happens is the interest rate goes up. You have to pay more now to hold money, right? You have to pay more to hold money. So people are going to hold less money if the interest rate goes up, right? It's very similar to the price of anything. When the price goes up, your quantity demand goes down. So we have this kind of straightforward, traditional looking demand curve. It's very similar to the demand for any good, except now we're talking about money, right? The ability to have liquidity in our hands. Now, what makes this money market a little different is who determines the supply of money. Does the market determine the supply? The Fed determines the supply, right? And so what makes this market a little different is it set by the Fed? The Fed, through open market operations, can change the supply of money. Okay. This then, sorry, now my pen's not working. I think I've maybe figured out one of the problems. I think if I mistakenly have the pen in my hand and I walk like a step away, it loses connection. So I'm trying to remember to leave it, but then I forget, right? So then, sorry. What determines this equilibrium interest rate is the supply and demand for money. Okay. What interest rate are we talking about? It would hear. In this money market, we're talking about a short-term interest rate. So I'm going to put a ST here, a very short-term interest rate. The interest rate would be, we're really talking about a short-term interest rate. Which is the interest rate that the federal fund, or I'm sorry, which is the interest rate that the Fed focuses most on? Something called the federal funds interest rate. Remember from yesterday, what's the federal funds market? Anybody remember what the federal funds market is? Yeah, Evan. Yes. Okay, well, that just shot my theory to hell. Because I left it sitting right here and it still didn't work. The Fed focuses most on the federal funds interest rate, which is the market for interbank lending. Okay, in the market for interbank lending. So most of this lending here that takes place in the federal funds market is overnight. Meaning it's usually measured in hours, not months or years. It's hours. Why would banks be lending money to each other overnight? Do a lot of loans go out in the middle of the night? Why might some banks need money for 12 hours, 8 hours? Any ideas? To meet required reserves, yes, exactly. So every day, banks have to meet their required reserves, right? And so what happens at the end of the day? At the end of the day, some banks are going to be short of required reserves. Other banks are going to have excess reserves. And so what do? The banks with excess reserves lend it to the banks with required reserves. And you might say, well, why would you lend it for 8 hours? You can't be getting that much money, can you? Yeah, you can. Because even if it's a very low interest rate for 8 hours, if you're sitting on $1 billion, that's a lot of money, right? So when you're talking about big amounts of money, you don't want to let that money be sitting around and not making interest. even for an hour, right? I mean, that's really your job as a money manager, is to be making sure that every second that money is earning something. And so this is what happens at the end of the day, right? At the end of the day, some banks are likely to be short of required reserves. They borrow it from banks that have excess reserves. What is that interest rate? The federal funds rate. And that is the interest rate that the Fed pays the most attention to, okay? So if I could redraw this graph, you could think about our FFR, right? Meaning the federal funds interest rate, where the supply is set by the Fed and the demand for money is set by the market. Primarily, what's the Fed doing when they change the money supply? They're controlling the amount of excess reserves. They can create new reserves, they can destroy reserves. And what's the demand for money? Banks trying to meet their required reserves. So this would be what we would call the federal funds market. And there is an equilibrium interest rate that balances. Okay. All right, this is very important if you're gonna understand the Federal Reserve, because this is really the interest rate that people who want to know what the Fed is doing follow. Because this is what the Fed follows on a day-to-day basis. This is the interest rate that they pay most attention to. Why? Because the Fed views this as a benchmark interest rate. And by that I mean, that what happens when the Fed starts to change the federal funds rate? That then impacts all other interest rates, okay? So one of the things we see is that interest rates tend to move together. And so if the Fed puts upward or lower pressure on the federal funds rate, other interest rates will tend to move together, right? You can see this just a little bit. This isn't the most recent data, but it just gives you some idea about how interest rates tend to move together. So this is looking at interest rates in March of 2019 and interest rates in March of 2020. If we looked at interest rates in March of 2021 right now, we'd see that interest rates in March of 2021 are relatively close to where they were in March of 2020. And so notice what happened here. The Fed significantly reduced the federal funds rate, right? And we'll talk about why the Fed did that. But what happened when the Fed reduced the federal funds rate? All these other interest rates tended to go down, right? The only interest rate that didn't really go down is on interest-bearing demand deposits or interest-bearing checking accounts. Why didn't they go down more? Because they were already almost at zero, right? They can't go down much more than that. So yeah, when the federal funds rate goes down, other interest rates tend to go down proportionally. And when it goes up, it goes up. So the Fed's primary tool, as we're going to talk about, is open market operations. And their primary target is interest rates. Before I talk about this a little bit more, how is it? Just so the, because this might be a point of confusion for a few of you. You might be saying, how does this relate to our loanable funds market? Right, because we've talked about interest rates before. Remember our good old loanable funds market with savings and investment? And interest rates, right? This seems like a much different market. right? This seems like a much different market. And it really is, right? You have to think about this theory as more of a theory of the long run, right? In other words, yes, in the long run, savings and investment plays the biggest role in determining interest rates. But in the short run, it's the money market and the Fed that plays the biggest role. Okay? While the loanable funds market, as I said, is more of a theory of the long run, you got to think about this as more of a theory of the short run. So, you know, this is something we have to do a lot in economics, is balance kind of two models of the way that the world works, right? Which one is wrong and which one's right? Well, they both have their strengths. The loanable funds theory, I think, once again, tells us more about interest rates over long periods of time, where this federal funds market kind of tells us a little bit more about why interest rates go up in the short run and why they go down in the short run. So let's use this loanable funds theory then to think about do open market operations impact interest rates? Let's first talk about an open market purchase. So what happens in an open market purchase? The Fed buys T-bills. How do they pay for them? Pushing a button, yeah. Yeah, I thought you were saying something goes down. No, yeah, pushing a button, right? They push a button and basically the bank then gets a transfer into their account, right? That is new reserves. What the Fed has done is they've created new excess reserves. These are excess reserves that have never existed before. And it increases M1, the money supply. What pressure then is this going to put in our federal funds market? Where we have the supply and demand, and we have that interest rate. The Fed has created new supply of reserves, right? That's going to shift the supply curve this way. And the Fed is going to cut the federal funds rate. So when the Fed increases the money supply, what do they do to interest rates? Put downward pressure on interest rates. Okay. In fact, you know, you really have to think about interest rates in the money supply as being the flip side of the same coin, right? In the sense that these things have to go together. If the Fed increases the money supply, it has to put downward pressure on interest rates, right? They have to go together. And so this is what happens in the federal funds market. If the Fed decides they're going to conduct some big open market purchases, it creates a lot of excess reserves, increases the supply of money, drives down interest rates, right? Drives down interest rates. So when the Fed wants to drive down interest rates, they conduct open market purchases. What about the flip side? What happens if the Fed would conduct an open market sale? What happens to interest rates? Well, this is really just the mirror image, right? The Fed now sells Treasury bills. They get money back. And what do they make happen to that money? It disappears, right? So they reduce excess reserves. They reduce M1. And so what happens here? Is this reduces the supply of money and it puts upward pressure. On the federal funds rate. And what, when the federal funds rate goes up, what's that going to do to other interest rates? It's going to put upward pressure on other interest rates, right? So we're going to see treasury bill interest rates go up. We're going to see long-term corporate bonds go up, right? We're going to see the prime rate, right? Which is the rate that you borrow money, a prime customer would borrow money from a bank. That's going to start to tick up, right? So when the Fed puts upward pressure on this interest rate, it will put upward pressure on other interest rates in the economy. So that's the first part of this, right? If we can back up here, remember what we're trying to explain is the link between tools, targets, and goals, right? We've gotten this far. We've just explained how the Fed's tools of open market operations impact its targets. Now we got to make the next step. How do these targets impact the goals? How does a change in the Fed's targeted federal funds rate impact its goals? Okay, now this is where we're really getting down to the nuts and bolts of understanding how central banks work. We have to be able to understand this goal that the Fed has for itself. The Fed's primary goal is to balance the trade-off between inflation and output. And the key word here is there's a trade-off. Because obviously, maybe I should be a little bit more specific here. The Fed wants low inflation and the Fed wants high output, right? So just to be clear, and hopefully that's obvious, but I think the Fed wants low inflation and the Fed wants high output. What's the problem? The problem is when the Fed tries to drive up output, what's it also likely to do? Drive up inflation, right? And so there is a trade-off here. And this is the trade-off that the Fed has got to try to figure out a way to balance. How do they do that? What's their approach? It is essentially what we talked about on Monday when we talked about fiscal policy, leaning against the wind. In other words, instead of talking about countercyclical fiscal policy, the Fed follows what we call countercyclical monetary policy. Right? Countercyclical monetary policy. Okay. So, once again, the idea here is very similar to what we talked about on Monday when we talked about countercyclical fiscal policy. What's different is the tools. Okay, where fiscal policy uses taxes and spending and deficits, monetary policy uses open market operations and interest rates, right? But it's really the same sort of idea. So, what should the Federal Reserve do during a recession? So we have this Keynesian recession, right? Where output has fallen and prices have fallen. This would be, you know, probably very, very close to the what's been going on in the U.S. economy right now with the COVID recession, right? Is that people got scared, they don't want to get sick, they're worried about their jobs, and so as a result, spending has dropped. As spending has dropped, we've fallen below the natural. What should the Fed's response be? Wants to help me out. What should the Fed's policy be? If the economy is slowing down, they want to. Yep. But the Fed doesn't control government purchases, right? They don't control taxes. Decrease interest rates. They want to cut interest rates. And how do they cut interest rates? Increasing the money supply, open market purchases, right? So the Fed's policy should be open market purchases. To increase M1, to lower interest rates, with the idea that what are these lower interest rates are going to do? Lower interest rates will increase investment and increase consumption, right? It'll encourage people to invest. Encourage people to spend. And what's that going to do? Increase aggregate demand. That's the idea. And so if we go back to our graph, what should the Fed be doing here? Shoot, I kept it in my hand. Oh, come back. While we wait for my pen to come back. The Fed should be increasing aggregate demand back up, right? Driving output back up to the natural rate. There we go, right? They should be increasing aggregate demand and driving output back up to the natural rate. That's what they should be doing. They should be leaning against the wind. So when the economy slows down, they hit the accelerator. Once again, this is symmetrical. They don't just do something during bad times, they have to do something during good times too. What should the Fed do during an expansion, particularly one that pushes us above the natural rate? So output's gone up. That's good, but notice here there's a worry. Inflation. Inflation's starting to go up. And so we don't want that, right? And this is the balancing the trade-off part. Yeah, we can get higher output, but the problem is if we let output get too high, it's going to start to create inflation. And so how do we prevent that from happening? Who wants to help me out here with the Fed's policy now? What should the Fed's policy be? Dane, help us out. What should the Fed's policy be? They want to decrease aggregate demand by doing what? They want to increase interest rates. And how do they increase interest rates? Open market sales. So raising interest rates, reducing aggregate demand, conducting open market sales. And if they do this right, not only do they drive down output back to the natural rate, but they reduce inflation. They reduce inflation. So once again, let's just go back to that little flow chart I had just to reemphasize this. The Fed's got tools that lead to targets that lead to goals, right? And so there's essentially this flow chart that the Fed has to work through. You know, basically you can think about this working backwards. If the Fed thinks they need to increase aggregate demand, what are they gonna have to do? They're going to have to stimulate investment and spending. How do they do that? Lower interest rates. How do they lower interest rates? They increase the money supply. And if they think aggregate demand is too high and the output is above potential output or the natural rate of output, then they have to reduce spending. How do they do that? Raise interest rates. How do they raise interest rates? They cut the money supply, right? And so ultimately, the Fed is balancing a trade-off here, the trade-off between inflation and output. They want to keep output at the natural rate. Yeah, they want to keep output at the natural rate, but they also don't want inflation to get too high, right? That's the tricky balance that the Fed has to find. And, you know, as we're going to talk about, this is no mean feat to do this. Because it's one thing to write this up here and show it on the screen, but it's another thing in the real world where we don't have nearly as good a definition or information about what's going on, right? So when I draw an aggregate demand, aggregate supply graph up here, yeah, it looks obvious. But in the real world, it's not nearly as clear often what's going on. And so that's the challenge for the Fed, is that in a world of uncertainty, they got to figure out how to do this. But at least, you know, at the broad scheme, from a broad perspective, this is what the Fed's trying to do. They're trying to do this. So let's talk a little bit more about this, because now that we understand the big picture, we can begin to like maybe critique this a little bit. Or at least try to understand why it's so hard to balance this trade-off. How does the Fed do this in practice? Well, believe it or not, there is a way to describe what the Fed does. The Fed's behavior is actually pretty well explained by something called the Taylor Rule. And so the Taylor Rule is not, let me back up here and just make clear what I'm talking about when I talk about the Taylor Rule. The Taylor Rule is named after economist John Taylor, who basically went back and looked at past Fed behavior. He said, you know what? Actually, the Fed looks as if they're following the rule. They weren't, but if you look at it, they actually look like they were following a simple rule. And what's that simple rule? Taylor said, if you look at their target federal funds rate, it was basically this. And strangely enough, the target they picked was directly related to what the inflation rate is and what the unemployment rate is. And if you think about this rule, it makes sense given that what we talked about, right? Because what does this rule say? What should happen when the unemployment rate goes up? What does this rule say? If the unemployment rate goes up by 1%, how much should the Fed cut its target? 2%. Setting the numbers aside, does it make sense that when unemployment goes up, the Fed would reduce interest rates? Yeah, that's what they should do, right? Interestingly enough, it appears to be kind of like on a 2-to-1 ratio, right? That if unemployment goes up by 1%, then the federal funds rate, they typically reduce the federal funds rate by about 2%. That makes sense, given what we've talked about. Likewise, what happens if there's an increase in inflation by 1%? The Fed raises interest rates by about 1.2%. Does that make sense? Yeah, because what are they trying to do when they raise interest rates? Reduce aggregate demand and reduce inflation. So, you know, interestingly enough, the Fed follows pretty straightforward, pretty predictable policy when it comes to setting interest rates. Now, once again, I want to be clear about this. I'm not saying that the Fed just plugs numbers into the federal funds rate and that determines their target, right? This doesn't determine policy, but we're saying that after the fact, right? After the Fed has picked policy and you look at it historically, yeah, they tend to follow this pretty predictable relationship. right? They follow this pretty predictable relationship, a relationship that's completely consistent with what we've talked about. Yeah.
The federal funds mechanism exists for electronic transfers.
Yeah. Yeah, it's existed for a long time, right? Back in the old days when you were doing things through telegraph or whatever. I mean, the big difference is the federal funds rate in the old days was only basically available to banks in the big metropolitan areas like New York. Like Iowa banks have a very difficult time getting access to it. Today, any bank, right, any bank can get access to the federal funds market. Well, I take that back. Any bank can get access, but not every bank does. Most small banks still don't have access to this. And the reason is, to get access, you really have to have some quite expensive technology, right? Encryption technology and payment systems technology. So a lot of small banks don't have it. So like that's actually a good question. Next time I'm in Hills Bank, I'm gonna try and ask somebody. And Hills Bank's a reasonably big bank in Iowa, right? I mean, they have branches throughout Eastern Iowa. It's not just in Mount Vernon. It's a reasonably big bank. I wonder if they do have access to the federal funds market. But any of the big national banks absolutely do, right? Any of them absolutely do. So that's the federal funds, or I'm sorry, the Taylor rule. And just if you look at the data, you see that the Fed tends to do the things that we're talking about. If you can see this here, the graph on the left-hand side, the blue line is the output gap, meaning how are we above or below the natural rate of output. And then the green line is the federal funds rate. And these things move together. In other words, when output goes up, when the blue line goes up, what does the Fed tend to do to the federal funds rate? Raise interest rates, right? When output's strong, the Fed's trying to raise interest rates and slow the economy down. What happens when output falls? The Fed cuts interest rates to try to speed it up, right? And the same, we see the same relationship with inflation and the federal funds rates. When inflation goes up, what does the Fed do? Raise the federal funds rate. And when inflation goes down, what does the Fed do? Cut the federal funds rate, right? So, you know, once again, this Taylor rule explains the Fed's behavior pretty well. In general, what does the Fed put more weight on, output or inflation? And what I say here is, I guess the best way I can explain it, they tend to focus on what's most out of whack. So what's the Fed focusing most on now? Undoubtedly output, right? Because we're in a recession. And because inflation is low, right? And so output seems to be the most out of whack. If you've been following the news, and so this is a great article to talk about, there's been any number of articles here published the last couple of weeks talking about evidence of rising inflation fears in the United States, some evidence that inflation is beginning to creep up. And so a lot of people are now wondering, well, what's the Fed gonna do? How long are they going to let inflation creep up before they're going to think, oh, inflation is the thing that's out of whack? And once the Fed decides inflation's the thing that's out of whack, what are they going to start doing? Raising interest rates, right? And so I think that's where the market is. The market's always looking forward, right? And so I think that's where the market's looking forward. Believe it or not, the market has already looked past the recession, right? The market is expecting the recession to basically be done. And they're expecting a period of actually fairly fast growth here in the summer and the fall. And so what's going to come along with fast growth and high aggregate demand? Higher inflation. And so markets are now wondering, well, when's the Fed going to raise interest rates, right? When's the Fed going to get worried about this inflation? So once again, you've got to understand how the Fed works. You've got to understand the Fed's tools and targets and goals to be able to understand any of this discussion, right? Because without knowing what the Fed's trying to achieve, it can be just kind of confusing. So as I said, in many ways, the Fed is relatively predictable.
This is looking, the purple line is the what the Taylor rule says the Fed should set the federal funds rate target at. And the green line is what the Fed actually set the target at. And you can see that they're very close. There's only one period where they were out of whack. And what is that? Look what happened in 2008. What did the Taylor rule say the interest rate, the Fed should set the interest rate at? Negative 6%. What's the problem with negative interest rates? Well, we'll actually talk about this. It is possible to get negative interest rates, and countries have done it. But it is a sign of a very sick financial system. And it's not the kind of policy you usually want to pursue over the long term. And so the Fed has been very reluctant to drive interest rates below zero. So during the 2008 financial crisis, they drove interest rates right to zero, but they did not try to drive them any lower. And we'll come back and talk about this. So outside of this kind of unusual period, yeah, in general, the Fed follows this Taylor rule, you know, pretty closely. And once again, I'm not saying that the Fed just gets a calculator out and says, okay, that's what the federal funds rate target is, right? But I'm just saying, if you look in hindsight, yeah, you know, that simple rule does explain what the Fed does, a lot of what the Fed does, pretty well, like pretty well.
So I want us to read through, to make sure that we understand this, I want us to read through the Fed's most recent statement. Sorry, I forgot to pull this up. Hold on one moment. I want to make sure I pull up the most. Here we go. Okay. So what I want to talk through here is the most recent statement by the Federal Open Market Committee. So as we talked about yesterday, the Federal Open Market Committee is the group in the Fed that sets monetary policy. Okay, they're the group in the Fed that sets monetary policy. So they meet every 6 weeks in Washington. The last time they met is January 27th. And so after they meet, they issue a statement. And basically the statement is explaining what they're doing, okay? And so I think now that we've talked about this, we can kind of read through the statement and somewhat understand, not everything, but somewhat understand what the Fed's thinking and maybe getting a little bit of an idea of what the Fed's gonna do going forward. Now, the thing you'll notice about these press releases is they all kind of follow the same basic format, right? So every press release kind of follows the same format. So if you read enough of these, you kind of get used to how they work. So it says the Federal Reserve is committed to using the full range of tools to support the U.S. economy and promoting maximum employment and price stability goals, right? So the Fed's saying, what's their goal? Low inflation, high output, high employment, right? That's their goals, the two goals that we've talked about. The next thing, COVID-19 is causing tremendous human and economic hardship. Okay, the pace of recovery and economic activity and employment has moderated in recent months. And the Fed's saying, right, things don't look bad, but they don't look great either. Weakness concentrated in the sectors most adversely affected by the pandemic. Weaker demand and declines in oil prices have been holding down consumer price inflation. Overall, the financial conditions remain accommodative, right?
in part reflecting policy measures to support the U.S. economy and the flow of credit. All right, that's a lot. What is the Fed saying now? Output growth is not super high, but the good news is inflation is pretty low. This is despite the fact that the Fed has been keeping interest rates very low, right? So the Fed has been doing what it can to try to keep interest rates low and credit moving. So, you know, the economy still remains fairly weak. The good news is not a lot of inflation. The bad news is output is not that great. The path of the economy will depend significantly on the course of the virus, including progress on vaccinations. The ongoing public health crisis continues to weigh on economic activity, employment, and inflation, and poses considerable risk to the economic outlook. The Fed is saying that basically they're not epidemiologists. Right? That in some sense, this is hard for them because the economic recovery is really based on what's happening with the virus, and that's hard to predict. So by saying that there's considerable risk to economic outlooks, what the Fed is saying is really things could change. Things could get better, things could get worse. There's a lot of uncertainty here. So the committee, once again, seeks to achieve maximum employment and inflation at the rate of 2%. I was gonna talk about this here in a minute, but the Fed actually has set for itself a target inflation rate that it wants to achieve, and that is 2%, okay? So given those goals, inflation is running below 2% right now, and the committee will aim to achieve inflation moderately above 2% for some time so that inflation averages 2% over time and longer-term inflation expectations remain below 2%. Whew, that's a big word. What the Fed is saying is we are going to drive up inflation, not just to 2%, but a little bit above before we back off. Right? So they're saying that, yeah, we are not going to start raising interest rates until not just that we see inflation back to 2%, but till we see inflation a little bit over 2%, then we're going to start raising interest rates. Right? So this is actually an important statement from the Fed. This generated a lot of news because what the Fed is saying here is that we're going to be more aggressive in pushing output here in the foreseeable future. Right, that they are not going to hit it in the brakes anytime soon. The committee expects to maintain an accommodative stance of monetary policy, basically meaning low interest rates, until these outcomes are achieved. The committee decided to keep the target range for the federal funds rate at 0 to 0.25%, essentially zero, right? The Fed has federal funds rate, interest rates, essentially zero. And they expect it will be appropriate to maintain this target until labor conditions have reached levels consistent with the committee's assessment of employment and inflation, blah, blah, blah. In addition, the Fed will continue to increase its holdings of Treasury securities by $80 billion a month. Once again, the Fed continues to be doing open market operations. By increasing their holdings of Treasury securities, they're saying they're gonna buy, right? We're gonna continue to buy about $80 billion a month. They're also going to buy mortgage-backed securities. This is still a remnant of the 2008 crisis. They're still going to be buying these asset purchases, help foster smooth market function, right? Trying to keep the markets going. The Fed is going to contribute some demand there. And then finally, this last paragraph always kind of ends with like, you know, looking forward. And in assessing the appropriate stance of monetary policy, the committee will continue to monitor the implications. The committee will prepare to adjust the stance of monetary policy. The committee's assessment will take account of a wide range of information. I don't know. It doesn't seem there's anything particularly interesting in there, right? The Fed's just saying, we'll do a good job. Don't worry about it, right? And then finally here at the end, you can see who voted for this. And Jerome Powell, who's the chairman, and then the next six are the Board of Governors. And then the last four are the chairman of the Federal Reserve Banks that are currently on the committee. And you notice here that this was unanimous.
right? So everybody voted for it. And as I said, this is one of the things about the Fed, is that traditionally it tends to operate in a kind of consensus-oriented way, right? And so, yeah, so that's the most recent statement. And so I don't think there's anything, I would hope that there's nothing particularly shocking in there to us, but that's good, right? That means that we're kind of understanding what the Fed thinks about, right? And you know, once again, even though the Fed appears to be this black box, I'll say that in general, you know, the Fed tries to be open and try to communicate with the public about what they're doing, right? And this is certainly true today, much more true today than they used to be. And so while the Fed has a lot of power, they do try to communicate. And in many ways, you know, it's not impossible to figure out what the Fed's doing. Not impossible at all. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the limits of monetary policy. Or, you know, how central banks can get into trouble or have gotten into trouble, right, in the past. Okay, one of the biggest limits to monetary policy is the problem of what we call the liquidity trap. What does a central bank do when interest rates get to zero? Is there anything else they can do? That has been, I think, something that every central bank in the world has had to grapple with the last decade or so, is interest rates have gotten very low globally, not just in the US, but globally. And so central banks have begun to think about, well, does that mean that we don't have any more power, right? Because once you hit the floor, you can't cut interest rates anymore, can you? So many central banks have worried that this is essentially a limit on the power of central banking. What we've seen, and this is, I think the Fed has been a leader in this, is that they've tried to invent new approaches. The Fed has tried to use new tools when they hit these interest rate limits. Such as? Quantitative easing. I believe we talked about this yesterday, right? I think we talked about this yesterday. This is the policy of not buying just short-term treasury bills, but buying long-term government bonds that try to drive down long-term interest rates, right? So in other words, what kind of interest rates have gotten to zero? Short-term interest rates. It's been short-term interest rates that have got to zero. So one thing that the Fed has tried is, well, why don't we try to drive other interest rates down to zero? Why don't we try to drive the 10-year interest rate, the 20-year interest rate, the 30-year interest rate closer to zero? And so that's been quantitative easing. And quantitative easing means buying not T-bills, but government bonds, right? It doesn't strike you as a particularly radical idea, but it's been fairly effective. Right? I mean, the Fed is not just going to sit around and say, well, we can't do anything. So let's try to drive down long-term interest rates. The other thing that they've been doing is Find other, what we call distressed assets, such as mortgage-backed securities. I remember mortgage-backed securities from 2008. Those are those bonds that are backed by mortgages. And one of the things that the Fed did is they bought a bunch of those because the markets had basically tanked. So what did the Fed do? Well, honestly, the Fed made a killing off this. They basically, when these things were in the tank, the Fed swooped in and bought a whole bunch of them. And a lot of those, the prices eventually recovered somewhat, right? So, you know, the Fed, in many ways, the Fed is uniquely poised to do, you know, what most good advisors tell you you should do, which is when everybody's selling, what should you do? Buy. And when everybody's buying, what should you do? Sell, right? The problem is most people can't buy when everybody else is selling because they don't have the resources to do it. Right? During a panic, it's really hard to buy because you don't have the money. All your assets have collapsed, but the Fed can do it, right? The Fed can do it. And that's what the Fed did. And so a lot of what they did by doing this is they just stabilized financial markets. And they reduced a lot of risk. They reduced a lot of risk in the financial system. Another tool that the Fed has not used, the Fed's been very reluctant to do this, but other central banks have done this, is push negative interest rates. Fed has not done this, but other central banks have. Okay, let's think about negative interest rates, because I'll be quite honest with you, this is almost like an Alice in Wonderland world, right? Where like everything is upside down in a world of negative interest rates. So think what a negative interest rate means. If you put your money in the bank for a year, what happens when you pull your money out of the bank a year from now? You get less back than you put in, right? You get less back. All right, what kind of incentives does that create? Does it create a lot of incentive for you to save? No, but it does create an incentive for you to spend, right? And so that's of course what these central banks are trying to encourage. Yes, it reduces savings, but it also does increase spending. However, it also encourages what we could call financial disintermediation, meaning people pulling their money out of banks. Because in a world of negative interest rates, what's a better way to save? Putting your money in the mattress is a better way to save than put it in the bank, right? Because if you put the money in a mattress, it's only gonna get eaten away at the rate of inflation. If you put the money in the bank, it could be eaten away at a higher interest rate. So, you know, listen, This is a topsy-turvy world, right? This is a topsy-turvy world. It is a sign of a sick financial system. And the Fed has been very, very reluctant to try to take the steps needed to push interest rates into negative territory.
Other central banks have tried it, which with what I would say very mixed results. In my opinion, the Fed has been smart to try to avoid this, right? In part because the first two things that we've talked about have actually worked pretty well, right? They work pretty well.
However, I do, you know, one thing I'll say here in conclusion is that sometimes the Fed is pushing on a string. Meaning there are real limits to monetary policy. There are limits. So why did I say pushing on a string? You can pull on a string, but you can't push on a string, right? So sometimes the Fed is buying assets and lowering interest rates. But is that going to make people spend? Not if they're super fearful. If people are freaked out and afraid, you can lower interest rates all you want. You can buy all the distressed assets you want. People are not going to spend, right? And so the Fed, any central bank can find themselves in a situation where they're pushing on a string. They're just pushing, 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 but nothing's changing on the other end. And so, you know, we have to be realistic about how much Fed monetary policy can do. And so, you know, not to get too philosophical about this, but I think many economists are really worried about the current situation that the U.S. has found itself in, because in the perfect world, you'd like monetary policy and fiscal policy to be dealing with economic problems. But what's increasingly true, our fiscal policy is so screwed up because our politics are screwed up. And so who does that leave to solve all of our world's problems? The Fed, right? So the Fed seems like they're trying to do more and more. When in reality, monetary policy is not some nuclear bomb, right? That can, well, maybe it is a nuclear bomb, but it's not some magic tool that can solve every problem. And so, you know, I think this is increasingly clear. Is that the Fed is really being asked more and more to do a whole bunch of things, but monetary policy is a very blunt instrument, right? It's a very blunt instrument, right? It's not a scalpel, it's more like a sledgehammer. And so, you know, I think there is this real danger that we kind of expect so much out of the Fed to solve all of our economic problems when it simply can't. So that is certainly one of the limits of monetary policy. Right, that's certainly one of the limits, is that we have to be realistic what monetary policy can do or what it can't. Even though the Fed has experimented greatly and tried a number of different things, you know, it can't solve all of our problems, right? It can't solve all of our problems. Work. All right, here it comes.
Another limit of monetary policy
is the problem of inflation, right?
That a central bank could try to get so focused on output and begin to push up inflation.
Let's think about an example here.
What would happen if your car spent an
Okay, so I'm going to draw a big graph. I guess I'm going to make it this way. This is just our aggregate demand. Walk away.
Not to add another technical problem, but I'm having some issues hearing you.
Oh, are you? I'm probably sometimes stepping away. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now. It was muffled before. I was getting weird.
Okay, well, I'm sure it's the mask and stepping away and everything. All right. Okay. Yeah, one of the great things about using markers and chalk is I never had to worry that when I stepped away from the board, my chalk would stop working. Okay, so here we have our economy with a natural rate. But in this example, let's say that the Fed wants to keep output up here. Right? The Fed wants to keep output up here. So in other words, the Fed doesn't care what the natural rate is. Or, I mean, another scenario is they just don't know what the natural rate is, right? They misestimate. And they try to keep output too high. Or here's another scenario. The next president puts the people he wants to into the Fed, and all they try to do is try to get that president reelected, right? And they figure, well, you get reelected. Sorry, hold on. Something weird is going on. Okay, there we are. So, you know, the president sticks the Fed full of his cronies, and to get him reelected, they just say, well, you'll get reelected if we drive output up, right? And just make the economy as strong as possible. So if this is what the central bank is doing, what should their policy be? This is really not working super well. What should their policy be? Well, I'm waiting for my thing to work. They want to increase aggregate demand, right? I didn't draw that very well. They're going to try to increase aggregate demand and drive output up. Of course, what's the impact of that going to be? Higher inflation. Eventually, what's going to happen? People are going to raise their expected inflation rate. Short-run aggregate supply will come down, and we'll go back to the natural rate. So what should the central bank do? Do it again. If it worked once, let's do it again. But of course, what's going to keep on happening? Right. This is just going to go up and up and up. If the central bank is committed to this policy, we are going to get accelerating inflation. And that, of course, is the danger. Right, that is the danger of giving policymakers too much flexibility, right? In other words, are we sure that policymakers are going to do it like we do it on the board, right? Or could they make mistakes? Could they get co-opted? Could they begin to think about politics, right? That's a real danger, right? That's a real danger. Monetary policy in many countries doesn't work nearly as well as it does in the US. What's one of the reasons why monetary policy has worked well in the US? Because we have a relatively independent central bank. And by independence, I mean that the Federal Reserve actually has a lot of leeway in setting their own policy. They are somewhat protected from politics. And the idea is by protecting them from politics, they are more likely to do what's in the best interest of the economy long term. Okay? So the idea is the same behind the Supreme Court, right? Why is it that we don't elect members of the Supreme Court by vote? Well, we want some people that have some expertise, right? And we don't actually want them to think about what their vote should be to get it reelected. So we have a nominating process, right? And then once they're there for life. Somewhat similar to the Fed. They're not there for life, but they're there for 14 years. And the idea is that once they get there, then they will think about things in the best interest of the country, and they, you know, will be there for the long run, and they won't play politics. That's the theory. In practice, it's worked pretty well. And one of the things that we see definitely in different countries is different countries have much different inflation rates. One of the determinants of what your inflation rate is how independent your central bank is. If your central bank is more independent, we do see evidence that this reduces inflation. The more independent central banks have lower inflation because they have people there that can think about the long term. But is the central bank perfectly independent? No. Remember, the Fed was created by an act of Congress. So in the future, could a president in Congress revoke the Fed or just put their best friend there? Yeah, in theory, it could happen. Right? In theory, it could happen. So for instance, this did not happen, but at the end of his term, Donald Trump, there's an opening on the Federal Reserve Board, and Trump nominated a woman who was not an economist and had written extensively about how the US should return to the gold standard. Okay? Now, in economic circles, that's kind of like being nominated for like a professorship in math and saying 2 + 2 = 5, right? I mean, it's like the height of stupidity to economists, right? And yet Trump nominated her. Senate Republicans said no, which was good, right? But what happens the next time, right? You know, this is the danger, right? This is the danger of having a, you know, the Fed is independent, but they're not perfectly independent. And they feel the pressure, right? This is, I think, something that was very different about Trump. I don't know what happened there. This is something that's very different about Trump relative to the most recent presidents, is at least the most recent presidents before Trump very much tried to stay out of the Fed's business and give it a lot of independence, right? Trump much more heavily got himself involved in Federal Reserve policy than in the past. And it just goes to show you how shaky central bank independence is, right? I mean, it really very much depends upon who's in office, right? And future presidents, you know, who knows, right? Who knows? But as I said here, I'm just gonna stop this. Just to go back to what I talked about a minute ago. That there are big differences across countries in inflation rates and money growth, right? And a lot of this just has to do with the quality of their central banks and how independent their central banks are. So, you know, you see here Turkey, They've got about a 50% money growth a year, and they have about a 40% inflation rate. What's going on in Turkey? The central bank is basically run by the president of Turkey. And so this becomes his, essentially his own bank that he pays cronies with, that he uses to influence policy, that he helps himself get reelected, right? And you can kind of go on and on down this line. Israel, the inflation rate is high because I think that this is from a lot of data back in the 1980s. But, you know, if you kind of go along this line, you won't be surprised that the countries that have the highest inflation rates are also tend to be the poor countries. And what's true about poor countries? We know they have poor institutions, right? So it gets back to this whole thing, right? Part of being a rich country is having good institutions, because good institutions, part of having good institutions is having central banks that actually know what they're doing and don't get co-opted by political processes and, you know, try to maintain low inflation over the long run. So that is a limit of monetary policy, right? Is that monetary policy doesn't operate in a vacuum, and things like institutions and politics really matter. Okay, there's a couple of things in chapter 15 that we didn't get to, but we'll save those for Friday. I've got to go get a COVID test. You guys know what I'm talking about. So anyway, I'm going to wrap up just a couple of minutes early. So yeah, let's all meet back on Zoom at 12:30, right? And remember, come prepared with questions, right? Come prepared with questions.